Welcome to Garuda. This is Will Sanchez. My special guest today is Dawn Sidcone. She is the founder of You Certainly Can Run. Almost 10 years ago, Dawn went out for a run. It was a clear, sunny day on the Jersey Shore. Suddenly, she and an SUV collided. Fortunately, Dawn survived. Actually, Dawn more than survived. She was reborn that day. I am honored to have Dawn as a guest.
Thank you, Will. That was great. And yes, I was reborn, absolutely.
Well, before we get to that momentous and pivotal day for you, let's introduce you to our audience. Tell us where you were born, a little bit about your childhood and your growing up years.
Well, I grew up in New Jersey, Colonia, as a matter of fact. I grew up in the 60s. So back then in the 60s, sports was not really big for women. And so I wasn't really exposed to anything. I did have two brothers, so that helped a little bit. I went to Catholic school my whole life. You know what? I didn't go to college out of high school. Back then, you know, girls were supposed to get married, and that was the way I was raised anyway. Uh-huh. So I did get married at 23 years old, and I didn't go to college until 10 years after I was married.
Uh-huh.
And in fact, I did my associate's degree, and then 10 years after that, I got my bachelor's. So it was a long process.
Well, you got a lot of life experience.
Yes,
okay.
Absolutely.
Okay, but at some point, running became an important part of your life. When did running sort of hit you?
Let me just tell you that during my childhood, because I grew up with a very strong father figure, he had a very strong work ethic. So he instilled in me that you certainly can kind of attitude. And growing up was difficult with two brothers. I did have a lot of, it was a rough teenage life, but I got through all of it. And it was through actually a process of, I was a smoker. I smoked 2.5 packs a day.
Did you start as a teenager?
I started as a teenager around 16, 17 years old.
Because you wanted to look cool with the other kids?
I wanted to look cool, but also I think it was actually a way of weight maintenance. Back then, a lot of girls smoked because then they didn't feel like eating. And that's coupled with, at 15 years old, I developed an eating disorder. And that stayed with me for decades.
Now, by an eating disorder, you mean a GI distress or you abusing food?
No. Actually, I borderline anorexia, bulimia.
Oh, my gosh.
Dysmorphia, yes.
Okay, so you had body image
issues.
So
I had a lot of body image issues. And so when I was dealing with that and the smoking, which was then causing wheezing and all kinds of physical problems, the doctor said to me, you know, Dawn, you need to start doing something physical, or you might wind up, you know, with phlebitis or something. I didn't know what phlebitis was, but he scared the heck out of me.
Sounded like a scary word.
I decided that, I don't know why, I thought running was simple. I'm going to start running. And what I did was I basically trained myself. I knew nothing about running. My first try running was with regular shoes and a pair of shorts, and I picked out a block. And I ran, walked until I can get to the end of the block. And then every day I did a little bit more until I could run a little bit further. And finally, when I was able to run the whole distance, I just started increasing it and increasing it. And I found that it was so much more. It opened up a whole world for me. It was a relaxing thing for me. Once you got used to the breathing and the muscles, not hurting anymore, it became very relaxing, and it opened up my mind. It helped me step out of my body, so I wasn't caught in that whole dysmorphia thing, and that was freedom.
How old were you at that time?
I was 27.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, I was older.
So you were married?
Up until then, I had, yes.
Did you have kids at that point?
No, I have a daughter now. But I didn't have her until I was 32.
Okay.
So she wasn't part of, thank God, that picture.
Okay. Now, usually when you start running, you run into other people that are running. Did, do you,
Well, I was a solo runner, and I would run around the neighborhood. And actually, one of my neighbors was a runner, and he had said to me, after this is going quite a few years now of running, just keeping it, you know, quiet, he said to me, why don't you come with me and run a race? And I said, Bill, no, you don't get it. I'm not one of those runners.
Oh, no.
I'm not like a runner. And believe it or not, I actually won. The first race I ever ran, I won. I won this big trophy. And I loved the camaraderie of it and the exhilaration. And it was in New Jersey at the Jersey Shore, and it was for the benefit of the fire department, so it was perfect. I also like the idea that most of the races are for charity.
Yes, yes.
Which is very important.
That blink, you know, and you get to keep it too.
I did, and I still have it.
You still have it. You went your first.
I still have it.
So what happened after that?
I wanted to start challenging myself, and I did have my daughter, and I actually ran to the day before I had her, and 3 days after.
Wow.
I actually pushed my daughter in a Prego, a borrowed Prego stroller running, and then eventually bought the jogging stroller, and she grew up in the jogging stroller.
Wow, that's interesting. And your doctor obviously was okay with you doing it.
Oh, yes. And my OBGYN was a runner. So that helped.
Oh, they call that running with cargo, you know.
Well, and you know what? Not to get off of the subject too much, but I am now a grandmother of a five-month-old, and I'm buying a new jogging stroller.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah.
All right, so here you are with a newborn. You're still running. You got your first race under your belt. So what's going on? Are you going to do more running? Are you going to go to the marathon? What was your thinking?
Well, I started doing the races. At the time, you know, I was married. I'm no longer married, and there was a lot of stress because I was the physical, active person, and my husband wasn't. So he wasn't very supportive. So I didn't get into the marathons and the heavy-duty running until actually after my divorce. And that's when it really excelled. I got very involved with the Jersey Shore Running Club, became a very active member, decided, in fact, my first marathon was a New York Marathon, 1996.
Uh-huh.
And I did it on a dare, because all of my friends said, well, you know, we're going to run a marathon, and the longest I've ever run was 13 miles, and I said, I'm going to go. And I actually did the marathon, and not bad for my first, it was like 4 hours and 10 minutes.
Wow.
But I was dying. But as soon as I crossed that finish line, it took about a week to get over my soreness, I signed up again and again. And then up to now, I've done 23 marathons.
Oh, my gosh.
Yes.
Various states.
Various states. I've done New York a few times, Boston, Marine Corps. I've even gone to Costa Rica.
International.
Which, yes, international.
You get to see the world.
I did. And my daughter accompanied me. Mostly on all of them, which is
excellent.
Great.
Excellent.
Yes.
Excellent. And, now, do you have all these marathons? Do you have a favorite?
I think my favorite right now was I did the Lost Dutchman recently.
Where's that?
That's in Arizona, and that was beautiful because it's in February when it's cold here, and you get to go there, and it was warm and sunny, and then I after the marathon, I could run the mountains.
Oh,
in the
my
desert.
Gosh.
It was beautiful.
Now, sounds like you've gotten faster doing those times. Well, you said you won your first 5K.
I won my first.
Was that a harbinger of Boston qualifying, for example?
Well, you know what? I hate to say that I just naturally, I would pretty much win my age division in most of the races, and I've always just qualified for Boston just about every year. And so at some point in time, I had to try Boston. So I actually did it twice, but I was very fortunate to.
So you had this natural running ability.
I think so. It was because it was a release.
Okay.
It was a real release for me.
Okay.
And my PR is actually Marine Corps. It was a 318.
The People's Marathon. Beautiful marathon.
And that was a beautiful marathon.
318. Excellent.
My most recent marathon. Well, actually, after my accident, I obviously couldn't run. It took me about a year and a half to actually get back onto the road, even though the doctor said you're never going to run again.
Well, let's go back.
Okay.
That's a very pivotal time in your life. And it's astounding that you're sitting here saying that you still can win the races for your age group. So take us back almost 10 years ago.
Okay.
So tell us what happened that day.
I'm doing my daily run, which would be from my house to Sandy Hook, which is a beach on the Jersey Shore. And it involved going over a bridge. Well, going over the bridge that particular afternoon, it was a beautiful sunny day, a car decided that it was going to pass illegally. And it went over like the divider into the safety zone. And it hit me. And luckily, because they were exiting the Sandy Hook Park, it was only going 25 miles an hour.
Sure. An SUV. This is a
big
car.
It was an SUV. I did damage to that SUV. But it actually sent me soaring over the car 15 feet. I mean, I had like 30 stitches in my head.
Oh, gosh.
I shattered this leg here, my tibia plateau. This knee was popped out. It was
scary.
And I do actually remember laying in a fetal position on the bridge and watching all the traffic line up, school buses and everything lined up, not realizing what had happened.
They just saw you.
Yeah. And in my mind, I'm thinking, look, just get me to the hospital, fix me up so I can finish my run.
Really? You would think of finishing?
Honestly.
A true runner.
The way the Highlands Bridge is half the bridge is in Highlands and the other half is in Seabright. So they're standing over me saying, what hospital do you want to go to? Do you want to go to Monmouth or Riverview? And I'm like, I don't care. Whatever's closer.
Interesting. So they finally took you to the hospital.
They took me to Monmouth Medical. And I spent like 3 weeks in there. And the funny thing is, you know what I really love about running is that most runners really know their body very, very well. They know, you know, more than a doctor could ever tell them about their body. So I'm telling them that this knee is killing me. And they x-rayed it and they said, it's not broken. It's fine. And I'm like, no, you don't understand. There's something wrong with that knee. It took about an hour after they iced it for the swelling to go down and the whole knee just shattered in 5 pieces.
Ooh.
So, I had known.
Oh, but the swelling somehow held it together.
It held it together.
And the x-rays didn't show that.
No,
is that it?
No.
That's really weird.
It is weird.
Wow. How old were you at that time?
I was 50.
50?
Yes.
Oh,
and to
my
be
gosh.
50 and take that kind of trauma.
Yeah. Wow.
You know, I think being an athlete was
to my advantage. In good shape, so that
Absolutely.
Helped.
Absolutely.
But you needed, obviously, a lot of emotional support. Was that there? Was your family there?
My daughter was there.
Well, she was in high school at that time?
My daughter was in high school. And I remember her telling me she was in the middle of Michael's store buying arts and crafts because she loved that. And she got the phone call because I'm known in Highlands. And so the owner of a restaurant knew that it was me, and he called her. And she said, Ma, I just dropped everything. I jumped into the car, and I couldn't figure out why it wouldn't start. She jumped into the wrong car. So finally, she got to the hospital.
Nicer car, hopefully.
My family was there, and in a way, it's a blessing in disguise, because I believe if somebody was there to help me and take care of me, I would have leaned on them and not become the person that I am today. So what had happened was she had just gone to college. She had to go to college. So I got hit in April. She was leaving in August. Now I'm talking about, this is it, where you put me, I couldn't move.
So you went a body cast?
Bed cast, not a body cast, but I literally couldn't move.
Okay.
I mean, she was doing bedpan and everything for me. So she leaves to college. The gentleman I was supposedly seeing at the time just abandoned me. So I was totally on my own, other than the VNA coming in once in a while and helping me. And up until that point, I never liked to be alone. I was afraid to be alone. So here I am, looking out this little window, watching the world go by, and you have to kind of get to know who you are.
Yes, that's interesting. But before your daughter went to college, I remember reading this very nice moment you had with her. She was graduating from high school, and you were determined to get there. Tell us that story, because it's so
poignant. Well, what happened was, a couple weeks after the accident, again, I knew my body. I knew I had a blood clot, and the nurse came in and said, you don't have a blood clot. I said, I know I do. So she left. I called a neighbor. They took me to the hospital. I had a blood clot. Because, you know, you're running 50 miles a week and to nothing, and I'm not getting enough physical therapy. So I'm in the hospital now with a blood clot. My daughter's graduating high school. There's no way I'm missing it. So I convinced the doctor to allow me to give myself, you know, heparin shots. And I surprised her. And I had people take me in there in a wheelchair.
The way you read it in your blog, it sounded like a scene from The Graduate.
I was upstairs, the balcony of the college, and she was downstairs, and you couldn't hear a pin drop. And they're announcing all the names, and then they announced Antoinette Saccone, and all, I just couldn't help it. I just yelled out, "My baby!" And it was very emotional.
I know, when I was reading that, it took me right to The Graduate. I mean, a very different scene. Oh, yeah, she probably looked up. You know.
Yes, she did. All that was so surreal to me at the time. You know, it was all, my focus was not on myself at that point. It was being there for my daughter. I mean, I was a single parent since she was six. She's been there for me, and, you know, she slept at the hospital when I was in there.
Oh,
she was
God.
Taking care of me. You're
so
talking, a 17-year-old kid, you know, taking care of their mother. I'd ring the bell. I couldn't go upstairs in my bedroom. For 6 months, I had to sleep on a chair downstairs, so she was taking care of me.
So she grew up fast.
She did grow up fast.
Well, that's almost a side benefit to her. She got to spend more quality time than she ever cared to, but, you know, that's...
I did.
Now you're very close, obviously, forever.
Yes. Life's come full circle.
But there you are, and I think you said the doctor said forget about running.
Yes.
But
well, they told me I was going to be limping.
Limping. So why you didn't believe them?
You know what? I couldn't even comprehend that. It wasn't in my thought process that I'd never be able to run again. And I guess because my mentality of you certainly can and my father's work ethic, it was like, there is no you can't, there is no, you know, I've had people say to me, well, you could be permanently disabled, you know, you don't have to, you know, you could have just rolled over and went into depression. And my answer is no, I couldn't. That wasn't my makeup. So I immediately started to rehab myself. I mean, I'm getting a blood clot from somebody coming in, rehabbing me. It obviously wasn't enough.
Mm-hmm.
So when I tell you I'm doing crazy things like tying bands to my ankle and in the wheelchair on the coffee table and
okay, you're figuring out your
yeah,
own...
figuring ways to do range of motion and rehab myself.
Okay. So sometimes the coaching team, were you part of the coaching team? Sometimes they'll send the troops over to the house.
No, but they were there supporting me. It changed my life. It opened me up because I wasn't aware. I mean, I had people from a church, people never met me before, driving 30 minutes from their home, delivering me home-cooked meals.
Oh, that's excellent.
I mean, I had things, people that I never expected came out of the woodwork to be there for me. It touched my heart to the point where there's just no way. There's no way that can change your life.
Oh, my gosh.
Really?
So
I call it the tragedy that's my gift.
Gift. At some point there, I think... you were down and you're really in the dumps because the doctor weren't really that supportive.
No.
That you had made a decision if you couldn't run, you were going to do something very drastic.
Yes, I you have to, or maybe I can explain, when you suffer from dysmorphia and eating disorders and all of that, it's like you're not feeling really comfortable in your skin. When you find something that opens you up and makes you feel alive, you're not giving that up. So it came to the point where if I couldn't run because of my knee, I actually considered quietly, I didn't go telling people, I would consider cutting my knee off and replacing it with the spring because I had to run. And you know, it's not something I wanted to do, but it was a consideration.
But luckily, you didn't have
luckily,
to put that
I didn't
into
have
place.
To.
Oh my gosh! Because you got better and better.
I did.
Did your limp go away, or
I never had a limp.
Never had a limp.
Never had.
So the doctor.
And you know what I did to even make it more impact? I mean, when I tell you I won every age division, I've had shelves of trophies. I made the decision, other than my marathon trophies, because I have like two Disney World trophies and a couple other marathon trophies, I threw everything out. Because it was now we're starting over.
Oh, okay, reborn.
We're going, yeah, we are reborn.
New PRs,
you're going to prove yourself again. You're going to get those awards again, but you're going to earn it from where you're at now.
Okay, so you're only really 10 years old because...
Yes, I'm reborn.
How long did it take you to go from, you know, incapacitated to your first run?
About a year and a half.
And was it a 5K again?
It was a 5K. And I'm not going to tell you I won my age division, but I did.
You did? That's amazing.
And then I didn't think I could ever run another marathon because I still deal with a lot of issues, but I just ignore them because I can run.
Okay.
But I did finally do the Costa Rica marathon. It was my first marathon back after my accident. And I actually did that, I think it was a 3:58. It was
pretty
good.
Oh, my God, sub-4.
And the wonder, the beauty of it was my daughter flew out there to be there for me.
She's one heck of a daughter.
She is. She was at the finish lines when she was little at Disney World, and now here she was.
Oh, that's great.
A grown woman.
That's great. Now, Costa Rica is a hot... I've been to Costa Rica. It's very hot.
But I like the heat.
You like the heat?
I do.
Okay.
I don't want to sound like I'm bragging, but I'm proud. I won my age division.
Well, you should be proud. Well, it's not only pride, but, you know, it's a testament to your willpower and to the things you were doing to help yourself. And you weren't going to let those people that drove 30 minutes and made those food, you were going to do it for them, and you were going to do it for charity, it looks
Absolutely.
Like. You have lots to be proud of, and it's a good pride. I have to congratulate you for that. And you're inspiring other people. Well, you started this blog, this website, You Certainly Can Run. I love that title.
What I started is because of what I learned. And for me, it's a paradigm shift in your way of thinking. I don't see negative. You know, people look at like they're always supposed to be happy. And when negativity or sadness or adversity comes, they cave or they complain or they tense up. And I see them as opportunities. You know, they're opportunities to grow. Mm-hmm. And a lot of them, like my accident, was an opportunity for a miracle. And it's a paradigm shift in your thinking. And you certainly can. People get stuck under their limiting beliefs. You know, I see a lot of women when I cross the finish line and they'll say, like, oh, I can't do that. Or, you know, they want to run a race, but they don't think they're one of those runners. And I tell them, You are, and you certainly can. And part of my story proves that. And then I try to share that.
Okay.
So.
Wow. So it's been almost 10 years.
It's been 10 years.
Now, what are the top of three highlights of the last 10 years? That I know the birth of your granddaughter is one.
Birth is that's
in terms
huge.
You know,
running my first marathon back because I never thought I could do that.
The Costa Rica one was the first.
That was.
And international. That was great.
That was
a highlight. What were some of the other highlights?
Just being able to reach out and help, you know, inspire these women, really. I mean, I don't mean they're men and women, but most of them are women.
Because they relate to you being a woman.
Yeah.
Particularly, you've been an ex-smoker. Now, does that mean you do inspirational talks? People invite you to their church or to their corporate events?
I mean, there are more women, and think of it this way, all the girls that may be suffering from self-esteem issues that have fallen through the cracks are now middle-aged women who are, you know, under the wing of an abusive husband, maybe, you know, puts her down or whatever, or they're just caught up in not seeing their own power.
Yes, yes. Do you work with organizations that help women? You know, there are lots of domestic violence
centers.
Yes,
in fact, I do a race Saturday in the park for women, and that's specifically for abused women. And we do that on Labor Day weekend. Every year,
because it's amazing statistics. Like I think in the United States, one out of four women are abused one point in their lives.
Yes, what I found is that running empowers them. I mean, it gives them some kind of control. And you're talking about women that are constantly being berated or not thinking they're enough. Now they got some kind of control in their hand. And when they run and they realize that, you know what? That 5K that Dawn said I can run, that took me a little time to learn, and I crossed that finish line. Oh, my God.
Wow.
It just opens them
That's
up.
That's great. You also did a book of poetry.
I did.
Groups and...
Yes, and I wanted to just share with you, Will, if I may. It's someone's birthday tomorrow.
Oh.
And I thought, what an appropriate gift.
I have a feeling it's a book of poetry.
Yes, why don't you open that?
Why, thank you so much. How do you know it's my birthday tomorrow?
Well, we're friends. I know.
Facebook.
Yes.
Why, thank you. Well, maybe you can close out the show by reading a poem for us.
I can. And I wrote this book while I was recovering from my accident.
Thank you again.
Yeah.
Did you sign it? Oh, my God.
Yes.
Gosh, you're a special... Oh, I'm going to have to show this to my wife.
It's divided into emotions, and...
Well, read us one of your favorites.
Well, there's different sections in here, and one of them I wrote with regards to my healing. I needed something to make me remember what running was. It's called The Mountain, and it was me focusing on the top of the mountain because it was what got me... to, you know, once you're on top of your game, and once you've been there and you know what it's like to be top fitness and feeling good, you always want to go back there.
Yes.
This is all divided into emotions. My daughter said to me, oh my goodness, did you want to make yourself so vulnerable? You really exposed yourself. And I said, absolutely.
Wow.
How can people identify if you don't? So I had a picture with this. And if I don't need my reading glasses, I'll read it. The Mountain. When you stood on top of the mountain, all that surrounds you is in you, inhaling the sweet essence of purity. The body knows before the thought. Each muscle fiber reacts in perfect motion. Once you've stood on the mountain, you want to go there again. No hard training is a discouragement. Time is not a factor. The view may not be the same as nature changes things. But rest assured, it's my mountain, and I can handle any view. Do not stand in my shadow. Go create your own. I have gotten to the mountain on self-motivation, as only one can. I will stand on top of that mountain again, for that is where I left my soul. And that was what got me to come back to running.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.